Welcome to part 2 of this 12-part Python tutorial series for beginners. In this chapter, we'll learn about variables and primitive data types in Python. Variables in Python are how we can store data and then reference them later on. Here are some examples of variables. In this example, I have a variable called x, and the value is the number 9. I also have a variable called y, and the value is the word hello. To see how this works, let's open up our editor and actually write it up ourselves. I'm inside my VS Code editor, and I'm going to create a new file, and I'm just going to call it main.py. And here I'm going to type x equals to 9, and then y equals to hello. And if I click up here to run that, then nothing happens, nothing shows up on our terminal, because even though we declared these variables, we actually haven't done anything with them yet. We haven't told Python to print it out to the terminal. So to do that, let's just add a print statement and print out x. And then let's add another print statement and also print out y. So we'll hit save and then run that again. And you can see that the values of 9 and hello are now printed to the terminal. Now, what if I overwrite to the value of x before I print it out? I'm going to say x equals a, b, c, d here. And then if I run that again, I don't have the number 9 being printed out anymore, because by the time I reach this line here in my interpreter, the value of x has already been overwritten by a, b, c, d. So with variables in Python, you can create them like this, and you can also override their value. And whatever was the last value that you've assigned to the variable will be what's stored there when you try to access it, for example, when you try to print it out. And when you overwrite the value of a variable, it doesn't even have to be the same type as the previous value. So here I created a variable with a value of 9 as an integer, and here I've overwritten it with a string. It's generally not good practice to reuse variables for different types of data, but you can do that and Python won't complain about it if you do. It's just not a good idea to do it if you can avoid it. Now let's see what happens if we try to print a variable that doesn't exist yet. So here I'm printing out the word hello, but that's because I've set the string value of hello equal to this variable y. But if I delete all that and I just try to print the word hello on its own, what do you think will happen? If I run that, it doesn't work. There's an error here and it says name hello is not defined. That's because if you don't put a word inside quotation marks, Python doesn't think of it as a string or a word. It thinks of it as a variable and it's expecting it to be declared earlier in your application. So if I literally wanted to print out the word hello and not the variable hello, I can put this in quotes, and then if I run that, it'll be fine and it'll print out. But often I don't like to do this because I have values that the meaning to me as a developer is something, but the value it stores can be something else. So an example of this is something like a user. And to me, I don't care about who the user is specifically. It can be anybody. All I care is that that's the user that I'm dealing with. But we do need to define the user. So here I can do user equals to Jack. And if I print that out, it'll print out the name Jack, even though for me as a developer reading this, all I care about is that this is whoever's the current user. And I can change this to somebody else as well. So I run that again, and now it prints Alice. And generally, if you try to use a variable that hasn't been defined in Python, you will see this name error coming up. So if you see an error that looks like this, it's probably because you tried to use a variable that you haven't defined at that point in the program. And also, if you do come up against errors like this, but also maybe other errors in the future, you might want to search for it on the internet to get a clue on how to fix it. But just something to keep in mind is that the errors will contain very specific information about your file and your program. So if you copy-paste the entire error message into Stack Overflow or into Google, some of these words and names that are specific to your program might make it difficult for the real answer to show up. So if you do have a situation like this, I recommend you looking at what's specific to your program. So for example, here, the name user is specific to the program. I won't copy that. I'll just copy name error is not defined and then search for that. If you're using VS Code, the editor will help you identify variables that you haven't defined yet as well. Because here, if I'm using the variable user without first giving it a value, it's given me this little underline saying that there's something wrong with me trying to use that, that this user variable is not defined. And I can fix it by simply just defining it up here. So to recap, variables are references to data. So in this case, it could be the number 9 or the word hello. And in Python, we use variables whenever we want to refer to the data that they're storing when we're writing our program. Here, we've used x and y as our variable names, and I've just chosen that arbitrarily, for no special reason. In reality, we can actually use anything for these variable names, but there are certain things that make good names and bad names. Examples of good variable names include x, y, and z, because they're commonly used in math, as well as descriptive but not overly long names like temperature Fahrenheit. In Python, it's also conventional to write the name in all lowercase letters, with each separate word in the name separated by an underscore. You can't use a space in a name, so you use an underscore to separate them instead. Here are some examples of data that can be stored in variables. This includes things like numbers, decimals, text, and true-false values. There are some reserved words in Python, as you see here in this list, such as min, max, class, continue, and so on. And these words have special meaning and cannot be used as variable names. Additionally, variable names cannot start with a number, although you can use numbers after the first character. So if you want to write a variable like var underscore 1, that would be valid. So now here are some examples of variable names that are invalid, or they're valid, but they're not good variable names. The first one is min, which is one of the reserved words. So as you can see, our editor highlights it in a different color, and we can't use that. In the second example, we try to start the name with a number, and we can't do that as well. Now, in the third example, actually, from the third example onwards, these names are all valid, but they're not the best names. Var1 works, but it's not really descriptive. It doesn't tell me what the variable is or what it does. Student name is good as well, but the casing is wrong. Remember I said that in Python, it's conventional to use snake case, which is all lowercase characters punctuated by underscores. At first glance, the next variable name on the list looks like it meets all the rules, except that it's a little bit too abbreviated. I don't know what the proc word stands for in this case, and I don't know what CTR stands for. And it's common that if you work with a program or you work in your project, you might come up with very short abbreviations that you know, but that's bad practice to over-abbreviate things because in general, you want your work to be understood by other people, and they might not have the same knowledge as you do when it comes to the abbreviations. Or only use abbreviations when it's really, really obvious what they are for. Finally, the last one on the list, distance, that's actually a pretty good variable name, except that we can improve it, because something like a distance would actually have a unit with it as well. If you tell me the distance of something as a number, then I don't know whether it's meters, kilometers, or miles. So in this case, it's useful to actually add the unit name to the variable name as well. For example, it would be better to say distance underscore km in this case, instead of just distance on its own. Don't worry if you struggle to come up with good variable names from the start. There's definitely a skill that takes time to learn, and it's not easy. In fact, here's a famous quote among software engineers. There's only two hard things in computer science, hash invalidation and naming things. Now let's take a quick look at how we can use variables to represent real-world problems. If we wanted to build a game, we can use variables to represent things like a character's health, power, and speed. If we wanted to build a food ordering app, we might use it to represent the name of the item, the price of the item, and whether or not it's a vegetarian item. And if we wanted to make a finance or a stock trading app, then we could use variables to represent the different types of stock symbols, the quantity we wanted to buy, and what type of order we want to place, whether it's a buy order or a sell order. So that was just some quick examples of how to use variables with real-world problems. Now let's take a closer look at the values that the variables themselves can contain. They're shortened to int, float, str for string, and bool for boolean. Integers are whole numbers, so anything like 1, 2, 3, 4. Floats are numbers with decimal places. Even if you have a whole number, like 1.0, but it has a decimal place, that's still a float. Strings are anything surrounded by quotes, so that could be a character, that could be a single emoji, it could be a whole paragraph, or even a huge chunk of text. And finally, booleans are either true or false. So these are the four primitive data types in Python, and they are the building blocks to more complex data structures that we'll see later. Here are some examples using these different data types to create new variables. You can store these values inside the variable, and then when you want to use them later on, you can refer to them by using the name or the label of the variable. The reason for having these four distinct types of data in particular is to ensure that the data is stored in the most efficient and accurate way possible. Each data type requires a different amount of memory in storage, and having the wrong data type for something could potentially lead to inaccuracies. And another important factor is that the data type itself also gives us a clue about what we can do with the data. So here, if I have two integers, then I know that I can add them together. And if I add the two integers here, 2 plus 2, I'm gonna get 4, and that is also gonna be an integer. I can also add an integer with a float. In this scenario, the result would always be a float, even if the operands were actually whole numbers. So when you add a float to any number, the result is always gonna be a float. What if I try to add two strings together? I can actually do it, but it would behave quite differently. Strings are characters, they're treated as text, and they have no numerical value. So when I try to add them, it treats it as if I've just cut out letters out of a newspaper and pasted them together. So just keep that in mind, that even if the strings you have are strings of numbers, when you add them together or do anything with them in Python, Python will treat them as strings, and so you'll get results like this. So if I add the string 2 with the string 2, instead of 4, I'm going to get the string 22. Now that you know a little bit about variables and data types, you're probably wondering what you can do with them and how you can use them. Well, one of the most useful and basic things you can do with them is to make them appear on your screen. It's super helpful when you're debugging or just working on your app. In Python, we can do this using the built-in print function, which you've already seen before. But there's several ways to use this print function in Python. So let's take a quick look at them now. First, we can just print out a value directly. So for instance, here I don't even have a variable, I'm just printing out the string hello world directly with this line. But of course, the print function can also be used to print the value of a variable. So here, if I have a variable called x and I set it to the value of 12, if I print x, then I'm gonna get 12 in my terminal. You can also print out multiple values at once. So for example, if you wanna debug two values at the same time, you can use this print function and then just separate the values with a comma. And you can do this with as many values as you want, although it's probably a good idea to keep it quite small, maybe between 2 to 3 values at a time. If you want to work with larger than a handful of values, then stay tuned for chapter 5, where we're going to be looking at list, which is how we can work with a large amount of data. And when we print out multiple values with one statement, they don't always have to be the same data type, and they don't even all have to be variables. You could combine text and variables in a print statement. So I like doing this if I want to print a variable, for example, like x, but I also want to label it in the print statement. So here I can put a string like hello, and then when I print it out, I'll get hello 12. You know, I can change the string to whatever I want to be descriptive when I'm printing this out, but that's just a handy trick to have. And if you're using Python 3.6 or above, then my favorite way to print out something is to use a format string, which is also called an F string. This is a popular approach because it allows us to easily combine text and variables. So here, you start by just writing a string with double quotes, but you put the letter F at the front, and it turns into a format string. And then you can open the curly brackets, as you see there, at any point you want in the string. And in there, you can put any variable or any value you want, and it will replace that in the string that it prints out. Now, the F string isn't even a feature of the print function. It's a feature of the string. So this is useful even if you just want to create a string where you want to insert specific pieces of information throughout the string. So as you're going through this tutorial, I actually recommend you opening up your terminal and then trying out all these examples for yourself, just so you can become more familiar with them, but also see how they actually work. So let's go ahead and try that last example. Let's create a variable called x, and I'll give it the value of 12. Now I want to print out x with a format string, but instead of printing the format string directly, I want to create another variable called the message, which is going to be the string, in case I want to use it for something else. Normally, when you print out information or you log it, you might also want to save it to a file or save it to a database for safekeeping. So it's useful to actually have our messages stored inside the variable. So let's do that. Let's make it an F string. So it's basically just a string with the letter F at the front. And then I'm going to write the value of X is, and then open your curly brackets, and in there you can put anything you want. And here I'm just putting x. Now I have x and the message. Let's actually print just the message. So now if I run that, I get this output. The value of x is 12. I think it might be useful to end this chapter with a coding exercise so that you can practice what you've learned. Imagine that you're building an e-commerce application and you need to describe some items, like their name, their quantity, what the price is, and whether you have them in stock. So for this exercise, I want you to think about how you'd model this data. What variable names would you use for each of them, and then what would be the type of data? Pause the video now for a moment, and then write a few lines of Python to describe these things, and feel free to plug it in with some example data. Once you've had a moment to think about it, then feel free to resume the video. Okay, so I hope you had a chance to think about it, and this is probably what I would answer for that question. So for the item name, it's going to be a string because the name can be anything. In this case, I've chosen appled, and the variable name is item underscore name so that it sort of matches Python's snake case convention. Quantity can be an integer, so here I have quantity equals 4, because you're probably going to have whole numbers of the quantity of your item. You're not going to have half an item, for example. So an integer is probably the best choice for this. For the price, I've named it price underscore USD, because as I mentioned, when you have something that can have ambiguous units, it's better to have the unit specified in the variable name, so that when you use it or other people use this variable, there's no confusion about what it's storing. And in this case, I've chosen price to be a float, because if we're dealing with USD, we don't always have whole numbers. We usually also have decimal places with the numbers, especially when dealing with items like Apple, which is quite cheap. And finally, whether or not it is available in stock, we've chosen a Boolean. It's best to store that as Boolean, because that's the most efficient data type to express that type of information. So that was a quick introduction to variables and data types in Python. If you get stuck or have questions, then leave me a comment in the video or check the links in the description for where you can get help. See you in the next video, where we're going to take a look at operators in Python, which lets us manipulate, compare, or do other useful things with our data.